This is an auto-narrated audiobook generated by Google. Book: The Story of Eros and Psyche, retold from Apuleius, together with some early verses. Author: Edward Carpenter. Year: 1923. Introductory note. Though the story of Eros and Psyche is alluded to by various earlier writers, our only source for its details is, I believe, in that animated and amusing romance, The Golden Ass of Apuleius, where it occurs as an episode and where it is told at considerable length and with elaboration. Apuleius was a Roman citizen of Madaura in N. Africa and was born about 130 AD. He inherited a large sum of money from his father, and after spending much of it in extensive travels, settled down ultimately to a literary life at Carthage, where he was held in great honor. He had an inquiring, adventurous turn of mind and character, uniting a thorough enjoyment of life with a tendency to mysticism and Oriental speculation, the theosophy of the time, which shows itself in his works. He is said to have been initiated in the mysteries of various religious fraternities. The story of Eros and Psyche, or Cupid and Psyche as he calls it, probably came to Apuleius through Greek channels, but it seems to be one of those world-old fables to which it is difficult to assign a date or locality, and which, owing to some hidden pregnancy of meaning, are graciously received in all ages and places. In this respect, Eros and Psyche may be compared with Cinderella and with the Sleeping Beauty, to both of which stories it shows considerable resemblance both in detail and meaning. Cinderella, the Cinder Maiden, sits unbeknown in her earthly hutch. To what extent Apuleius may have amplified and elaborated the material that came to him, it would be impossible to say. As a writer, he is full of invention, humor, lively wit, and varied learning and experience, but his style is often overloaded and affected, and the story as told by him is somewhat involved and laborious in places. In retelling the story, I have taken the liberty, while adhering to his outlines, of using Greek instead of Latin names for the divinities, also of cutting down the details and transposing and slightly varying a few items, with the view of rendering the whole more transparent, so to speak. For the conduct of Aphrodite, however, who is represented as bawling and brawling in so undignified a way, Apuleius is alone responsible. Here and there, I have adopted a phrase from the excellent translation in Bone's Classics. For the rest, there is a prose paraphrase of the story by Mr. Walter Pater in Marius, and one in verse by Mr. Robert Bridges, which may be consulted by those interested in the subject. As to the early verses here reprinted with Eros and Psyche, they are selected from a small volume entitled Narcissus and Other Poems, which was published by Henry S. King & Company in 1873, i.e. some 50 years ago. I was at that time at Cambridge, and I vividly remember the care and even anxiety with which, following the ideals then and there current, I launched these first attempts at verse. Nor is it impossible that as specimens of the work of that period, they may, notwithstanding their juvenile character, present even now some points of interest. E.C. Topic: The Story of Eros and Psyche. 1. Once in a certain land, there dwelt a king and queen who had three daughters, the eldest charming for her bodily grace, the second equally charming for her wit and intelligence. Even as children, everyone admired these two. But as time went on, it began to be noised abroad that the third and youngest was, after all, the fairest of the three. The name of this one was Psyche. She was retiring, shy perhaps, nor had she all the gifts of her sisters, but it was seen that there was something unearthly in her beauty, some strange light in her countenance which entranced those who gazed upon it. Indeed, it was whispered here and there that she was fairer than Aphrodite herself, whom all nature adores. And some, actually deserting the temples and the service of the foam-born goddess, came and paid their worship to the lovely maiden. To Psyche herself, there was no pleasure in all this. The innocent child thought nothing of her own beauty, nor did she care for the renown and worship it brought her. She longed for love, but these things only served to make a distance between her and other people, and to make love more difficult. She felt sick and lonely, and when presently her sisters, hearing the common talk, became envious and full of unfriendliness, she felt lonelier than ever. But her fame continued to spread, and at last reached the ears of the great Aphrodite herself. Now when Aphrodite heard, she was very wroth, and hurrying over the beautiful ocean to the edges of the land, she called her son Eros, and, "What is this I hear?" she said, "that my altars are deserted, and men, leaving me, are paying their sacrifices to a maid of mortal birth? Truly I am incensed beyond measure. But I will make this impudent hussy know her place, and who it is that even Zeus, the Lord of Heaven, pays homage to. Go thou, my son, and sharpening thy keenest arrow, cause her to fall in passionate burning love with some wretch, some renegade, the very lowest of mankind." Then, sealing her command with a kiss from her fragrant lips, she mounted her rosy ocean car drawn by white doves, and sped forth over the laughing waves, surrounded by troops of Tritons sounding their melodious shells, and the daughters of Nereus sporting over the deep. But Eros obediently, having selected a dart and disguised himself with the garment of invisibility, went forth to seek Psyche, that he might wound her. And at last, after some searching, far in the interior of the king's palace he found her. And lo, as soon as he set eyes upon her, he was wounded himself. He, the god of love, was overcome by her beauty, and pierced as with an exceeding pain. Yet did he not dare to declare himself, for fear of the anger of his mother, but returning his arrow to the quiver retraced, for the time being, his steps. Meanwhile Psyche sat at home, and felt herself lonelier than ever. Though men praised, yet came none to woo her for a bride. Her two elder sisters were already mated, and to powerful chiefs, but she, a forlorn virgin, faint in body and weary at heart, bewailed her lonely plight, and loathed her own beauty though it delighted the rest of the world. Thus, and filled with strange forebodings, she sat, till at length her father, foreboding ill himself, suspecting the hostility of the gods and dreading their anger, determined to consult the ancient oracle of Apollo. And lo, when he did so, the voice in words of deepest dread pronounced as it seemed her inevitable doom. "For, take her," it said, "attired as for her funeral to the top of some high crag, and leave her there, a wild and tameless husband she shall have, and for her wedding bid the world goodbye." Then the king, misunderstanding the meaning of the oracle, and the queen and the whole land with him, were greatly grieved and plunged in mourning. 10 days they passed in tears and lamentations, but on the 10th day they formed a procession, and conducting her to the summit of a high mountain, went through the rites as for her burial, and then, with torches inverted and loud wailings and plaintive strains of music, leaving her alone in that dread place, they took their homeward way and abandoned themselves to despair. But Psyche meanwhile lay trembling and weeping on the summit of the rock, till Zephyr, the gentle god, came and caressed her with his soothing breath, and at last, fluttering and playing amid her garments, gradually expanded them, till he lifted her up and, wafting her softly down the mountainside, laid her in the flowery turf of the valley below. 2. Now when Psyche came to herself, after her aerial flight, she found herself in some kind of enchanted garden. Lovely groves and thickets, streams and fountains were on all sides, and in the midst stood a palace of fairy beauty, all carven in cedar wood and ivory and gold. Soft strains of music, she knew not whence, drew her feet onward, and voices from forms she could not see hovered round, till at length she stepped across the threshold, when the beauty and richness of the interior still more amazed her. But what amazed her most was that this treasure house of the universe, as it seemed, was protected by no chain, no bar, no lock, but was open apparently to all the world. And while she wondered, an unseen voice addressed her. "Why, lady," it said, "are you astonished at such riches? All are yours. Repair therefore to your chamber, or to the bath, and refresh your wearied limbs, for we whose voices you hear are your handmaidens and will attend to all your commands, and when we have dressed you will serve some refreshment without delay." Psyche therefore obeyed the pleasant instructions, and when she had rested and bathed, sat down to a dainty banquet at which the dishes moved of their own accord, while the air vibrated with music and to the voices of an invisible choir. But when these pleasures had come to an end, and slumber began to press upon her lids.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.